right, welcome back in. 5:15 from the Princeton Orthopedic Associates studios. Enjoying a Monday talking about the big picture in the NFL and specifically the NFC with the Philadelphia Eagles, who have been dominant at 5-1. Now joining us on the hotline, someone I love talking football with, and I'm sure he's all pumped up after what his college football team did over the weekend, taking down the defending national champions in Clemson. That is Qadry Ismail, who's kind enough to hop on board with us right now. My main man, Q, what's up, man?
Zach, what's going on with you?
Nothing much, Q, but how about that victory over the weekend? Your Syracuse Orangemen defeating Dabo Swinney, the defending national champions in Clemson. I didn't see that one coming, Q.
Well, here's what happened. I had an appearance to do on Thursday night. That was the first time I was up at Syracuse, since 94-ish. And I think the Missile Mojo Magic was in force as the fellows was up there doing their thing. And that helped contribute to the proper mindset to say, yo, not today, not in the dome, not right now. Y'all about to take this L. So I'm taking credit for some of that success.
Hey, it was unbelievable. So you brought them some good luck. I like to see that. Hey, you look at this landscape of college football. Everyone knows right now that Alabama's the team to beat. But you got some really good teams. Penn State, Georgia, TCU, Wisconsin, Ohio State, Miami. And I'm sure I'm leaving out a few more. Who do you think's the best team right now to challenge Alabama, in your opinion?
Well, that's a tough one because obviously Georgia is sitting right there and looking good. I think Alabama, far and away, has this not only talent, but this balance of talent, coaching, and Nick Saban. Because of that, that's where I kind of stutter a little bit and say, well, you know, can Penn State be, I don't know. Boy, you know, I question, you know, you then again look at Georgia and you would say, okay, what are they all about? In the ACC, we just obviously saw Clemson take the L, so, you know, that's going to be kind of a toss-up. Florida State is obviously having a down year. Miami coming off of a good win against Florida State, but, you know, what does that mean as far as their program and growing? So, I don't know. Every week there's a different team that seems to kind of rule the roost. The next thing you know, they're falling by the wayside, and then you still got Alabama being Alabama.
Let me ask you this, going back to your college football days, and we talked about this a little bit on the Bob Saray Show with the Princeton football team. Let me bring up one of your former coaches, and Dennis Goldman, who's with the Princeton Tigers again. Tell me a little bit about what Coach Goldman meant to you.
Yeah, you know, I think for Coach Goldman, the biggest thing that he helped me understand was that I am a talented player that can play at a high level. You know, I obviously got recruited on the Eastern Seaboard. Every major Division I school had offered me and all that entailed, but I really didn't put anything together in my first few years there. And sure enough, here comes Coach Goldman. I think, you know, just his confidence in me, you know, giving me some tangible understanding of how to be a better receiver really changed my mindset, changed my game. I always felt I had a good work ethic, but once he gave me those tools, it was just, okay, let me go out there and be the player that I knew I could be. And, you know, sure enough, I was fortunate enough to have a strong finish to a slow start at Syracuse.
When you start slow, like, because here in Philadelphia, the first 2 years of Nelson Agholor were slow starting, and now he's having a really good year number three. I know you talked about how much the support of the coaching staff did help you, but how tough is that as a player when you expect to be better and you're just not playing well in your first few years?
Yeah, no, it's tough. You know, when you look at the NFL, everyone wants the instant, oh, you got it. And I promise you, it's the ancillary things that kind of get you. And what do I mean by that? You can literally, you know, my rookie year, I was living in Bloomington, Minnesota, compared to Eden Prairie, Minnesota. Well, Bloomington is rush hour traffic 30 minutes to 35 minutes from the facility. If you leave at 6:08, if you leave at 5:50, you're good. Now, if you're in Eden Prairie, you can leave at 6:20 and be sitting in front of your locker at 6:30. Well, when you're talking about the NFL and getting fined and the stresses and preparing yourself, little details like that can kind of make a day or break a day. And you're a college guy trying to figure things out, even in your second year. Sometimes, you know, there are changes in coaching staff. There's, you know, the draft. There's the free agency. There's all that goes on. And you're like, well, wait a minute. Am I on a team? Am I not on a team? What's my role? What's not my role? Things happen and change that people don't see. And you know, rightly so. That's fine. You know, you're a fan. You're like, hey, you know, you're just a pro. You make a lot of money. Go out there. But if you really want to know the why behind it, that's the why behind it.
Yeah, he had so many drops in his first 2 years, and now we're not seeing it. A lot had to do with now they're not asking him to be that number one wide receiver, and they're putting him in the slot, and that fits him better. But when you dropped the ball in the game, especially early on in your career, how did you bounce back from that?
For me, it was definitely one of those things where you got to look at yourself in the mirror, and again, you're looking at the bigger picture. Am I, you know, in a position where I know what I'm doing, or am I in a position where I need to work on my game and work on some things? I know I had some help with Dr. Saber, who was a ophthalmologist in Minnesota, and he did some amazing vision therapy work and taught me the understanding of the role of your peripheral vision and what does that do to help, you know, improve your performance. And so once I was able to get a hold of that and put some protocols in place to help me with my ability to catch, you know, my sports performance coach and I, we developed what I call a catch drill that I literally did probably for my third year on in the league. Every year, every game, every practice, I would do a certain catch drill and put forth those protocols, and you know, it helped me be a better, more consistent receiver. Some guys have great vision and it helps them. Other guys, they don't, and they don't realize it until it's a little too little too late. But if you're fortunate enough to realize it and get the proper help, then I think that you know, can put you in a better position to play better.
We're talking to Q Qadry Ismail right now on the Zach Gelb Show, Fox Sports 920, The Jersey. Eagles sitting high and pretty right now in the NFC, 5-1. No one wanted to see Aaron Rodgers goes down, but when he does go down, people are now talking about the Eagles being the favorite in the NFC. What have been your impressions so far from afar on the Philadelphia Eagles, what they've been able to do through the first six games of the season?
I think that they've been gamers. I think that they have an enthusiasm with one another when it comes to how they feel that they can play and the confidence in which they go about doing it. You can see that that's a lot of good, strong teamwork. There's not a lot of I guys, but a lot of we guys, which is rare in the NFL. I also like the fact that, you know, Carson Wentz, when, you know, you look at his quarterback play itself, you know, Doug Peterson has really, you know, helped him, I think, develop and grow even more so. It was good to see the deep ball in play and Torrey Smith kind of getting involved. You know, I think defensively, your secondary, wow, I mean, them dudes, they fly around and, you know, it's a challenge every week, but, you know, I could see that, you know, they're really up to it as far as how they compete. So a lot of good things, I think, are happening with them. It's now about trying to stay focused, and that's the main thing, and that's always a challenge.
That front seven right now is just playing at an all-pro level. Like, I don't know how many better front sevens there are in the National Football League, and someone that the Eagles did take away from the Baltimore Ravens, and we talked about him before in Timmy Jernigan, and you said, hey, he has all the talent, just has to put in the work. You know, Timmy Jernigan's being a real stud here in Philadelphia, and he's complimenting Fletcher Cox very nicely. That's one dynamic duo that they have right now.
Well, I think part of good secondary play is having a great front seven. Part of great front seven is having good secondary play. So I think one goes hand in hand. And to your point with, you know, Timmy Jernigan, I mean, the talent, we knew it was there, but it's just a matter of, you know, again, how do you be a pro? How do you consistently do it? It's one thing to do it, but it's another thing to consistently do it. And I'm glad the light turned on for him to consistently be able to go out there and make plays.
Get into Carson Wentz. I know you brought him up briefly, but you being around a lot of good quarterbacks in this league, when you look at Carson, what are the things that you like the most about his game? Because right now, you know, for a quarterback in his second year to be playing at MVP level, like those things just usually don't happen this early on in someone's career.
Well, I think part of it, again, is the bigger picture, you know, not just trying to isolate little things. You know, you have that reductionist mindset of, well, you know, if you look at Carson Wentz, his career is going to project the same way. You can't do that. You got to look at it globally. And if you do look at it globally, you look at the consistency of, you know, what they brought in when it comes to the receivers and trying to put guys into position. I know you guys talked about Agholor going into the slot and all that entails. I think for Carson, it's about, you know, the game slowing down for him, not giving him too much early on, but then as he grabs a hold of and owns things for himself, then that's where you can improve upon and get a better understanding of where he needs to go in his career. So all of it all matters when it comes to the quarterback play. And obviously there's a direct correlation of he plays well, everybody else plays well. And, you know, it snowballs into a good season or good start to the season so far.
And you look with how much he's had on his plate the first 2 years and how he's adjusted and taken advantage of that. And not only that, like, I knew he was going to be a good quarterback, Q, when you just talk to some of these guys in a locker room, because there's not a lot of times guys come into the league in their first or second year and the guys in the locker room talk about him like he's been around here for 8, 9, 10 years. Like, that's the importance of his leadership right now with these guys.
The quarterback position in the National Football League, I mean, that's the term. Well, that's what you get paid the big bucks for. You know, but
you're all
so
about these
true
cliches today.
Yeah, man, I'm just high off of my my win. Yeah. Up at the Qs, but
and it was
all
because of that talk that you gave him, right?
See, I'm telling you walk up on campus, good things happen. But I think, you know, that's what it is. It's that ability to mentally, you know, lock in and recognize your mantle and recognize, you know, the responsibility that you have. But, you know, I think it's again, it's how you go about it. It's how you present yourself. It's how you interact with others. And a lot of that has to do with, I think, Doug being a former quarterback himself and, you know, understanding, you know, what it is and what it's going to take to be a good, strong leader, effective leader.
With Doug, because a lot of people were skeptical, including myself, after what we did see out of the first year, but I've always been someone that has said you got to give a coach 3 years before you decide to move on. And right now, he's making everybody that doubted him regret those words early on. Mike Lombardi said he is the most unqualified hire maybe in the history of the National Football League. And when those remarks were said by someone that used to be a well-respected executive of the National Football League, guys here in Philly, they took that personally because they like Doug Peterson. He's described as a player coach. You've been in those locker rooms before. When people criticize a coach that you really like, you know, is that a little rallying call? And could that maybe play into effect why this team is 5-1 right now?
Well, I mean, I don't necessarily know if you're going to go that far as, you know, correlating, hey, man, I like my coach, and, you know, you all of a sudden have a winning record. And hear what I'm saying, because I've seen that where you like your coach, but still the dude gets fired because of other things that are outside of your control. I will say this, though. For Doug, and it's interesting because he and I spent some time up in Green Bay when I was in training camp up there before I got traded down to Miami. And I think him being around Brett Favre, being around Andy Reid and everyone else as a player, around Mike Holmgren, seeing how things are done, just because you're the superstar, that doesn't necessarily translate over into the coaching aspect of things. But sometimes when you're the guy that has to develop and has to pay attention to every little detail because of the fact that you don't have that superior, just God-given talent, sometimes that helps you be a far, in a way, better coach to see everything. And then you putting together a staff that now, you know, your ego is put at the door. The staff is able to do their job effectively. And the end result is you have a good record. I mean, everything works hand in hand. Are there going to be some challenges? Absolutely. Are there going to be some lean time? Sure. But I think that, you know, if you have a strong mental outlook and a strong plan that can be tweaked, not necessarily changed, but tweaked when adversity happens, good things happen, and that's a good thing for Doug Peterson and the Eagles right now.
Wrapping up with Qadry Ismail right now on the Zach Gelb Show, Fox Sports 920 The Jersey. Let's go around the rest of the league. I'm watching that Browns-Texans game on Sunday, and when I was watching Deshaun Watson move the ball up and down the field, and you know the Browns being in your division, I was thinking to myself, man, the Browns back-to-back years passed up on Carson Wentz and Deshaun Watson. Like, what an inept organization they are, Q.
Yeah, you know, I think part of
like they stink. Like analytics, like stop. Yeah, I know analytics are important, but they rely on those things too much. Like Watson and Wentz, you had to take a chance when you're the Browns on one of them. They didn't take either of them.
Yeah, no. I mean, I think, you know, Deshaun Kaiser, you know, he probably looked at that and thought, you know, hey, good. You know, now they got Kevin Hogan in there, and I think there's like 28, you know, the 28th starting quarterback since 1999, which is not good at all. I think part of his mindset, has to be, this is Hugh Jackson I'm talking about, has to be, you know, how do I get this team to turn around and believe that they're winners? I think that they're in such a disarray. I don't even know if, you know, you could have brought in some of the greatest quarterbacks of all time to play for Cleveland and it just wouldn't happen. I don't know. I'm kind of stumped because, you know, you would think that they would have had some level of success at some point in time, and they just simply haven't.
How the heck does Joe Thomas tolerate this? That guy has never missed a snap in Cleveland, has been there forever. He's a great football player, Hall of Fame football player. If I was him, I would have tried to get out like years ago, Q.
Yeah, no, I mean, he has been so consistent. And I've seen it, you know, in many a locker room where, you know, guys kind of sit down and say, not necessarily, you know, give up or quit or any of those things, but it just gets hard. It gets long. It gets boring. It gets tiring. It gets frustrating. You know, all those statements that come about when you are constantly losing because your body just goes through it. So I definitely commend him. I don't know why he would want to stay, but I commend him for, you know, putting himself in that position.
A team that's been surprising this year has been the Rams. Sean McVay is 31 years old. That's some coaching job to start off a career at 31 with the job he's done with Goff and the Rams.
Yeah, so again, you look at Doug Peterson, you see, you know, his pedigree and, you know, the people that have helped him. I think same thing with McVay. I think that, you know, just because you want the name guy, there are other young, talented coaches that eventually, if you look at it, they're going to step up and help guys be in a better position. Again, it's about your staff and also being smart about, you know, who's on your staff. You know, the fact that, you know, he doesn't have that ego that says, you know, it's all about me, but it's all about us and what we are all about. To get that team to play better, you know, sky's the limit for them compared to what they had a year ago with Jeff Fisher, who just kind of, you know, stuck in doing the same old, and just having that, you know, mediocre mentality.
Are you concerned about Atlanta? They're up 17 up against the Dolphins at home, and they could not hang on. Another choke for the Falcons. Where's your confidence in Atlanta?
Yeah, no, I mean, I think, you know, for Atlanta, it's about how do we win? You know, are we smart enough to win? You know, when I look at the Falcons, part of doing your job and at a high level and winning ball games is finishing off an opponent. And sometimes, you know, the freelance element comes into play, and that freelance can definitely set people back. I think that's what they're going to have to figure out, how to avoid, you know, just freelancing and doing, you know, things that are going to hurt you rather than help you.
Two more with Qadry Ismail, who joins us right now. The ruling in the Pats-Jets game. I've watched that play 100 times. I don't get how they overturned that. How about yourself?
Well, I mean, unless there's some kind of hidden camera angle thingy that, you know, you and I didn't see, I'm still kind of like scratching my head as to what went on. I don't know. I really don't know what to tell you. I thought that, you know, the Jets tight end, I forget his name, but
Austin
he literally
Jenkins.
Yep. he literally had it in his hand. You could see that it was moving, but it never kind of got away from him. It never hit the ground. It was just more of a bobble than an outright, oh, he fumbled it. It looked like it was just more of a bobble than anything. So, yeah, they missed the ball on that one and badly. I don't know. I feel bad for the Jets, but you know, the league needs to figure that one out. There's the letter of the rule and the spirit of the rule, and I mean, they just missed it on that.
Yeah, I don't get what they were seeing, and I went into this week's games and I said, and I say this every week, I don't know what pass interference is anymore. I don't know what a catch is anymore after seeing so many of these over the years. Now I guess we don't know what a fumble is or isn't, because he never, yes, that ball did come loose, but it never came out, you know, of his control fully. And it looked like, I watched that play, it looks like a touchdown. I just don't get it. And the ruling on the field
says it's a touchdown. That's the crazy thing about it. I mean, it wasn't like, again, I can see if it. I'm still stuck on the fact that Dez Bryant's catch way back when.
It wasn't.
That was a catch, you know? I mean, I'm like, man, maybe Tony Romo wouldn't be in the CBS booth right now if, in fact, they would have called it a catch. Who knows?
Hey, I'll end you on this. Since you brought up Romo, I don't think he's going to join the Packers. You know, I had someone tweet me, maybe Brett Favre will come back out of retirement, and they were being serious. I said, come on, guys. He hasn't played for a bunch of years. Could Kaepernick maybe go to Green Bay? I know he just filed that grievance for collusion. What do you think ends up happening in Green Bay?
He filed the grievance for collusion. Therefore, he ain't going
back. It's not happening. I agree.
Yeah, no, I think one thing, you know, we're going to see is whether or not Hundley can actually, you know, do his thing. And, you know, how is Mike McCarthy going to, you know, he has a complex system. He has a complex system because you got a guy like the likes of Aaron Rodgers, who has really worked incredibly hard to put himself into play with this complex system. But now you're going to have to dumb it down, and you're hoping that Hundley is going to be worth, you know, the metal to win ball games for you, and you're going to take some major bumps in the road. But, you know, this is unfortunate, but this is life in the NFL.
Will Kaepernick ever play in the league again?
I don't think so. I think that, you know, the story has been written as far as what, you know, the league is trying to do as far as the backups and everything like that. I don't think he will be playing, no.
Q, great stuff. I could talk with you all day. We appreciate you giving us some time. And once again, congrats to that Syracuse team. That was some game on Friday night.
Appreciate it, man. Anytime you want me on, just let me know.